So when we proclaim the name of Jesus, power is released.
Welcome to New Dawn Community Church, the message of the week with Pastor Randall Cutter.
Today is another installment of our question and answers for the month of July. If you are here, you have an opportunity today to be able to ask questions, which will drive our message today, because your questions is what I will respond to and hopefully be able to get a comprehensive answer. If you ask me a question that I don't know fully or that is I answer incompletely, I may come back to it next week. But in the meantime, if you do have a question, you have to go back and you have to be able to speak with Dawn, and she will either have you on video or will read the question that you want and written out, that you have written out for her to read. And we will continue this next week if we need to, although from what I saw, it looks like we'll be able to finish today, I believe. So, having said that as an introduction, go for it.
Okay, Randy, this question came in a couple of weeks ago from the congregation. Hebrews 9:27 says that it is appointed unto men once to die, and then comes the judgment. Since people have been raised from the dead, how can you refute the claims that reincarnation are true? Are there other verses that can explain this? This is also comes into play with Christians who believe that Moses will be one of the two witnesses during the tribulation.
Okay, so that's a good question, honestly, because of the fact that there's so much confusion out there. Right now, there are groups of Christians who are beginning to believe in reincarnation, but that's okay because Christians get involved in a lot of weird, deceptive things and end up, you know, they just need to have their theology straightened out a little bit. First of all, the scripture that was referenced in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, where it said, just as a man is destined to die once and after that to face judgment. Okay, that scripture is usually a scripture that we would use to say, see, that demonstrates that there is no reincarnation, because it's pretty obvious you're destined to die once and then the judgment. And unfortunately, and I've discovered this in every doctrinal realm that there is out there. And this is anybody who's studying the scriptures and seeking the truth and then seeing what others are saying about particular doctrines will find out something very alarming. Their opponents or those who disagree with their view will often use the same scriptures they are using, except twist them just a bit. Reinterpret them just a bit in order to make them come to a different conclusion. Or they'll read into the verses just a little bit. And this particular verse is one of the verses on the subject of reincarnation that they do that with. What they'll say is, yeah, in reincarnation, we say that a person dies, they enter the judgment, and then after the judgment, they're reincarnated based upon how their judgment was. And you say, but wait a minute, that doesn't make any sense, because a human being is not their body, it's their soul. See, we are our soul, our mind, emotions, and will. If you know that the scripture says that, then trying to reinterpret Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27 doesn't work. However, that doesn't stop anybody. And in fact, in any area of scripture that you look at, you will find someone who is attempting to reinterpret what the verse says. Now, here's the key to any interpretation of scripture. It is, there are three major rules that you need to follow in order to interpret scripture correctly. And they're the same three rules of buying real estate. If you're going to buy real estate, the three major rules you follow are location, location, location. Another way of saying that is, if you're studying scripture, context, context, context. And that means that you need to have the wider context of scripture in mind. You need to have the book that you're reading, the context of that book in mind. And then you have to have the context of the immediate scriptures in mind that the author was writing about. And when you keep context in mind, it's hard to rip a scripture out of the context and make it say what you want it to say. The reason that we have what are called the traditional Christian doctrines or the fundamental Christian doctrines are simply this. The context of Scripture requires the interpretation which has been given and put down in what we call fundamental Christian doctrine. The fact that we are born into this world under condemnation because of original sin that has come down to us from the fall. The fact that we need a Redeemer. The fact that Jesus is the Redeemer. The fact that He has rescued us. God became man and became one of us on the cross. That every human being has one life to live. And then at the end of that life, they will enter into judgment before the Lord. The fact that Jesus Christ laid down His life so that at that judgment, we are able to find forgiveness and grace and relationship that even impacts us now as we are establishing the kingdom of God on this earth. The fact that there is a final resurrection of the dead. And the fact that we will live with our God in the new heaven and new earth forever. You understand, I could have added a lot of different, you know, doctrines to that package. I'm just giving a brief overview. But those things are in Scripture in such an obvious contextual way that there is no way in the context of the book, in the context of the individual books of the Bible and of the individual writers of the Bible to make it say anything else. The main argument against, I'm not even going to say argument, the main fact against reincarnation is the resurrection from the dead. Okay? If reincarnation is correct, the resurrection from the dead makes no sense. Which body are you going to get? See, my understanding and Scripture's statement is simply this, that if I should die, Lord's coming again soon, might as well go for living till He comes. That's why whenever someone says, everybody in this room is going to die, I'm going, well, maybe you, not me. I mean, why should I want to, we know we're closer to the end than we were before. Why would you want to say, why would you want to claim that? I would rather say, you know, just like Paul, those of us who are left, Paul saw himself as one who was left 2,000 years ago. Why not claim, I'll be among those who are left, the remaining ones, okay? Well, let's have a little faith here. When someone says, we're all going to die, I'm always going, well, that's not certain. However, if we should die, you will be raised to life again with the body that you have been given on this earth. It will be perfected. It will be changed. It will be glorified. You will appear in Christ's glory. But I suspect that means that we will be able to recognize you, at least from pictures of your younger self. Saw some video of a friend of mine that I had had at in college and seminary last night. And I lost touch with him when we left the denomination that we had left back in 1995. Normally what happens when you leave a denomination, the people who are embedded in the denomination drop you like a hot potato because you're a risk to them. And so I haven't talked to this friend since 1995, and his name came up, and so last night I searched him out, and I found a video of him, and I looked at him, and I recognized him. I recognized his voice more than I recognized his face, okay? Because it's been almost 20 years, and there's, you know, time has not been kind to him. But I could see the vague features that was him, and his voice told me it was him. His speaking style told me it was him, and so I was able to recognize him, and it was kind of fun watching, listening to one of his messages online for about, you know, 3.5 minutes. And then I walked away from that going, okay, time has had changes on him, and as it has on me, obviously. He'd probably have the same struggle. However, the reason I bring that up is simply this. When we are resurrected, we will be resurrected at the optimal time. See, there's a certain point when, because of the fall into sin, that we quit growing and we start dying. I don't know exactly when that is, but I'm assuming it's between 25 and 30. It's when we stop growing to maturity physically, and now we maintain as we decrease. And that is the essence of death. And when I know that Jesus came to reverse death, when Jesus came to conquer death, I know that he's given us some keys. An evidence of death is sickness. So he said, fight sickness. I think we can also begin to pray for each other that we slow down the effects of aging. Why? That's fighting death. We don't have to accept these things. But anyway, that's a little bit of a discourse or, you know, a little detour there. But the fact that we are going to be resurrected in our current bodies, if reincarnation is true, it makes no sense. It just makes no sense. When the Apostle Paul said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain, it's not gain if you're going to come back as someone else. What he was saying is, I will be staying in the presence of the Lord in his kingdom forever. For me to die is gain. Whether to be home in the body or at home with the Lord. His home with the Lord, okay? He wanted to be home with the Lord. He wasn't going to get kicked out again into some other body. That violates the resurrection at its very core. Anybody who believes in reincarnation as a Christian is simply violating standards of logic and contradiction and believing things that the Bible cannot support. That doesn't mean that they won't rip things out of context in an amazing way to try to prove their point. However, it is not logical, and it contradicts other clear teachings of Scripture. So, okay.
Okay, on John 5 and 8, testimonies for Jesus, why does John not mention the transfiguration?
John 5 and 8, okay. When it's talking about the testimonies about who Jesus says, oh, Jesus... It's recorded in the other scriptures. Jesus, even when he was with his disciples, I believe it's Matthew 17, when Jesus was with his disciples, he said to them, tell no one what occurred. And John was there, of course, but he said, tell no one that what occurred as they came off the mountain, because Jesus did not want the transfiguration to become a distraction for people. His inner circle had a chance to experience it and then, of course, communicated after his death. So when John is recording the fact that Jesus is saying to people, believe on the evidence that you have in front of you, Jesus wasn't sharing the transfiguration as evidence. Okay? In all of those situations, Jesus was sharing what the people could see with their own eyes and what they could hear with their own ears. Jesus didn't say, believe on the reports that you have heard. He was saying, because he was there in their presence, he was saying, believe on the basis of what you have seen. And so, in the same way, Jesus said that if we do his works, we will find out that what he has said is true. Isn't that an incredible statement? If we do the works that he commands, we'll find out that what he has said is true. And to me, that's an interesting thing because you think right away, well, that's quite the requirement. First, we have to do what he says, and then we'll find out it's true. Well, the faith part is believing it before you do it. And then when you do it, you find out it's true. You have the experience. That's why the definition of faith that God gave me was simply living up to your level of experience of God. Because when you believe something and then you do it, you have an experience. Your experience is going to be that the Word of God is true. That's going to be your experience. Which means now to live in that experience of having done this is just faith. It's not great faith. It's living it up to your experience of God. What's your experience of God? If I do it Jesus' way, it works in whatever realm that is. And so now you have an experience of God. If you live underneath your level of experience of God, that's little faith. If you live above your experience of God logically, and I'm adding the word logically for a reason, if you live above your experience of God, logically, that's great faith. Why do I say logically? Because the only two people in the Bible that were called people of great faith were the centurion who wanted his servant healed and the Syrophoenician woman who who wanted her daughter healed. And the centurion based what he said to Jesus, living above his experience of his interaction with God, he based it upon clear logic of how the world works. He said, though I'm a man under authority, I just say the word and it's done in a distance. You can do the same thing. You don't have to come to my house. He based it on a logical understanding of how the world works, how authority works. And he said, so you don't have to come near me. The Syrophoenician woman, she looked at the situation around her. Jesus said, I've only come to the lost sheep of Israel. It's not right to give the bread that's supposed to go to the children of Israel to the dogs, those outside of the family. And he purposely said things in a way that should have offended her. She gets through her offense, builds a logical case. You know, I don't need the bread. You go to Israel and do what you're supposed to do there. I just need some crumbs. And in this world, any family will give the dog crumbs. You understand? She built a logical case based upon Jesus' own words. Lived above her level of experience of God. Both these guys had horrendous backgrounds. Both the centurion and the Syrophoenician woman, their understanding of deity was horrendous because the gods of that age that they believed in were mean and capricious and spiteful. And, I mean, you just read some of that ancient lore and you'll realize the God of Israel was an amazingly different presentation than any other of the demonically inspired deities which were around them. So it's important for us to recognize the fact that we live in our experience of God, and if we do so, we're living in faith. But Jesus, when he was confronting the people of his time with his testimony, was saying, you believe on what you've seen, not on the reports that you've heard. Then when he empowered his disciples, he said, you go on out and preach the gospel. You give the reports, but he also did something for them which was amazing. He gave the Holy Spirit, and he gave spiritual gifts, and he gave signs and wonders. So that people, even as they heard the word, were going to be able to recognize that there's power in the word, and they would see things with their eyes. I'll tell you that I believe in healing today, not because I came up with a rational understanding of healing and a theological understanding of healing. I believe in healing first because I saw healing happening around me. God was instantaneously healing people of incredible diseases in ways that just bent my theology. And so that meant that my theology had to be corrected, didn't it? I had to start digging in Scripture and find out what is it that I am wrong about in my theology, because something's going on. And I dug and I challenged my belief system, and I found out that contrary to the cessationist denomination of which I had been a part, that there certainly was healing for today. There certainly, the gifts were still active today. And so I began to pursue them based upon my new understanding of Scripture, but it started with an experience where I saw this thing happen and I began to realize I needed to pursue God in this particular arena. God has a tendency to invade our world in ways that challenge our misconceptions. He wants us to see what he's doing. Okay, I think that's answered that.
Okay, another question that came in this morning. With regard to the authority that we have in the name of Jesus, can you talk about 1 John 3:22 and 23? The Apostle John mentions believing in the name of Jesus as a requisite to getting our prayers answered.
1
John 3:22 and 23.
Thank you. 1 John 3:22 and 23. Dear friends, this is starting with 21, it's a paragraph. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because we obey his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. Those who obey his commands live in him, and he in them, and this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit that he gave in us. In the context of 1 John chapter 3 right here, in the development of the chapter, John is trying to help us understand the confidence that we can have in approaching the throne of grace. In Hebrews, it says we can approach the throne of grace with confidence. And that is really something we need to be able to understand. And so John, in 1 John chapter 3, says, "Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God." If we're not walking in condemnation that can come from a heart that doesn't understand the forgiveness that we have in Christ, we can really have a lot of confidence. And we receive from anything we ask, and you know, we continue to go after Him. Actually, it says in the verse before, whenever our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our hearts. And so we need to recognize that if we're having a time where we're thinking, I'm never going to amount to anything, I do things wrong again and again, our heart's condemning us, what happens is God is greater than our heart. What did God say? God said, "You are forgiven in the name of my Son." The Father has given us access to His throne through Jesus Christ, which is why we can approach the throne of grace with confidence. We don't approach because of who we are. We approach through who Jesus is. And so if we're approaching through who we are, we're in big trouble because our hearts will always condemn us. If our hearts won't condemn us, we have an enemy of our souls who will condemn us. Satan's not called the accuser of the brethren for nothing. So we've got all of this accusation which can come against us, either from our own heart, our own souls, or from Satan. And you know, it's easy for us to say, I have disqualified myself for being of any use in the kingdom of God. If that isn't something that's gone through your head, thank God for that. But most people have. Because you really, you know, you got the Holy Spirit living in you. You have a sensitive conscience that's being reinformed according to God's purposes and His will. And you just recognize that in your flesh, you know, it's true. Nothing good lives in your sinful flesh. However, your sinful flesh isn't the only thing you got now. You got the Holy Spirit indwelling your spirit, redeeming you, changing your character, changing your soul, so that you are becoming more and more a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, conquering those areas in your life that used to give you trouble by the power of the Holy Spirit. However, that's not the reason that we can approach the throne of grace with confidence. The fact that we've been overcoming things, we can approach the throne of grace with confidence because we have a great high priest named Jesus Christ who has gone ahead of us with the blood, sprinkling it so that we're able to approach the throne of grace. So in the immediate context of 1 John chapter 3, it's about approaching the throne of grace with confidence. We can have confidence before God and receive from Him anything we ask because we obey His command and do what pleases Him. And this is His command to believe in the name of His Son. Obviously, that's going to get us before the throne of grace. If we don't believe in the name of His Son, we can't get it to the throne of grace. So, the thing I heard in that question was the fact that we need to, something about why aren't all our prayers answered then in the name of Jesus. And by the way, if you're a Christian, you don't always have to say in the name of Jesus. You understand, it's not a superstitious phrase. We live in the name of Jesus. Okay. However, it's our tradition, and of course it gives glory to God, and we recognize publicly who it is in whose name are we praying. And so it's appropriate, of course, but I'm simply saying if someone doesn't add in the name of Jesus on the end of their prayer, it doesn't mean that they somehow are denying Jesus. They're living in Jesus. Their testimony is about Jesus, all of those things. However, because we love to give glory to Jesus, we often mention through whom we're praying. So the main issue we have is why aren't our prayers always answered? And that's a good question, of course, because we all have come into that. We think we're praying for something, and all of a sudden it doesn't look like it was answered. It says here, there's some qualifications. We receive from Him anything we ask because we obey His commands. Did you catch that last part? We receive from Him everything we ask when we are walking in alignment with His commands. You say, now wait a minute, I didn't read that qualification before. Well, you know, again, reading the whole context of Scripture, I can tell you that a lot of us walk in things that disqualify us for getting our prayers answered. If we're angry and we are, walking in a root of bitterness, and there's things that we're involved in that are less than godly. And, you know, it's like when Jesus was washing the feet of his disciples, he was saying to them, keep your relationship with me wide open. Don't let any presenting sin come between me and you. Be open to admitting your failures before me and asking me to help you overcome them. But a lot of times we camp around our sin, even refusing to admit it, deluding ourselves, creating a stronghold around the sin. If you've got strongholds in a particular area of your life, you have no authority in that particular area of your life because you've been deceived in that area of your life. And so let's just put it this way. If one of your strongholds is greed, how many prayers for wealth do you think the Lord's going to answer? Well, you know, I mean, it's like saying, okay, I've got a kid who loves candy so much, but it's bad for their health, they're approaching diabetes, and they ask you for candy. Oh, here, sure, no problem. Well, you wouldn't be a very loving parent, would you? Remember, the Lord is a loving Father. He knows better what's good for us than anything else. And, you know, when I think James is probably one of the best scriptures as far as understanding the types of prayers that the Lord, you know, the way the Lord wants us to pray. James chapter 1, James writes, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, he who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. Wow, what's the number one thing we should be asking for? God, who doesn't find fault with that request, will give us that answer. We need to be praying for wisdom on a constant basis because that will give us wisdom about how we pray too, will it not? Okay? But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt. Because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he'll receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. And so, you know, you're asking God confidently for this, you think, and all of a sudden you're doubting that he's going to respond. Here we have an invitation to pray for wisdom, but I doubt that I'm going to be wise. And you understand that's double-mindedness. That's not, you know, so you got this doubt right away. Here's the way that I work it when I pray. I simply say, Lord, I'm coming before you. I've prayed for wisdom. I believe you're giving me wisdom. I believe that I'm praying according to your wisdom that you have given me. I believe this is a good thing, and I'm asking for it, and I make my case. If I can't make a biblical case, if I can't make a logical case that doesn't somehow impinge on greed in my life when I'm praying for finances, or control of other people in my life, that's witchcraft, or, I mean, you understand, you start to think about, am I violating any of the fruit of the Spirit in this prayer? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Lord, I want deliverance and I want it right now. Well, you know, if you're hanging from a precipice, about to fall off, that's a pretty good prayer. But if you've gotten yourself into credit card debt, that's not the best prayer you could pray. Best prayer you can pray is, Lord, I want your help digging myself out of this debt that I have put myself into. I'm even asking for a miraculous response, but don't allow me to dig my way out of this 1 second earlier than I've learned my lesson. Oh, that's a hard prayer. But that's a dying to self prayer, is it not? It's acknowledging the fact. See, you're owning something. The Lord doesn't bless excuses. He blesses it when we own it. I just, he blesses it when we own it. When we say, boy, I really messed up there, Lord, sorry. Then he's washing our feet. The relationship is being opened up. And when we own it, we're able to say, oh, wow, thank you, Lord. And I'm asking that I learn the lesson from this. Why? I have children. When I teach them something, I want them to learn. The Lord has children. When he teaches us something, he wants us to learn. If I need to learn something from this, go ahead and use this experience as a way of teaching me so I am loath to repeat the same mistake again. What we usually want is a get-out-of-jail-free card. what we often need is a little bit of patience building and understanding how to never make this mistake again. In James also, verse 4, James gives another reason. Must be earlier. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You want something but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. Asking God is important. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you want on your pleasures. Boy, if you can make a kingdom argument for requests, you are in a really good place, rather than just focused on me, 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 me. Because you're starting to grow into that mindset of, I want to be able to help bless the kingdom. And when we do that, we start to see life released. God can entrust us with more, and there's like an upward spiral into his provision. It's the way it works. So anyway, I hope that explains that a little bit. It's just about answered prayer. We need to come into alignment with God in order to step into that place of answered prayer. He'll answer a lot of our prayers even when we're not in alignment because he loves us. However, he's not going to answer prayer, generally speaking, if it's going to spoil us and harden us. And we can be hardened. One of the reasons when a spoiled brat is a child asks for something and you give them that something when they're being spoiled, when they're having a fit, you've just bought more fits. More opportunities for the child to blackmail you. You can never give in to a spoiled tantrum because of the fact that you're just going to have more spoiled tantrums. And the Lord's wiser than that too.
Okay, another question is, many churches and denominations emphasize the importance of calling their leaders pastor, bishop, and the like. Yet here, that doesn't seem to be the practice. Can you explain this congregation's practice and why there are diverging views on this among Christians?
Yeah, and I'm going to, as I answer this one, I'm going to do the same thing that I do when I talk about it in our information class just a little bit as I go through. And the first thing I'm going to say is as I answer this, I'm speaking through the internet, and I'm speaking on television to people that belong to different churches that practice different things. I'm just going to share what I believe the Lord has shown me on this topic, and I believe it's scriptural, and I believe it's solidly scriptural. However, people have to walk in the light that they have. And so please do not use what I'm about to say to judge people whose practice is different than our practice. I am blessed to be a part of a ministry stream called Morning Star Ministries. It's not a perfect stream by any stretch of the imagination. There's no such thing. However, one of the things that I've really enjoyed over the years is that my heart for titles, for lack of titles, has pretty much been mirrored in also the leadership of Morning Star's lack of titles. We recognize the authority God has given to individuals, but we don't mess around where we have to call people titles in order to address them. Rick Joyner, who's the head of the apostolic stream, is Rick. Okay, we call him Rick. Even though he's the apostolic head of the stream, he's a pastor of a church and all of those things. It's just the way it is. Very relaxed. Now, don't mistake that for being overly, just a little bit overly casual. Because when you're around Rick Joyner, it's almost impossible to be casual, overly casual. The authority which he carries makes you respect him rather than any titles. And that's really the thing that God has designed, is that the authority of that a person carries builds the respect. Now, there is a particular group mentioned in the book of Revelation, which is pretty important for us to understand. It's called the Nicolaitans. The Nicolaitans are denounced by Jesus in the letters to the churches several different times. Also, those who follow the way of Balaam, those who follow that woman Jezebel, they're all denounced. And if you read commentaries, everybody will tell you what that issue was with Jezebel and Balaam. But then you get to the Nicolaitans, and they say this has been lost in church history. Okay, let me tell you why it was lost in church history, and I believe this firmly. The word Nicolaitan is made up of two words, Nike and the Greek word for laity, and laos is the name. Anyway, so it's conqueror of the people. Conqueror, Nike, people, okay? It's the conqueror of the people. And God's word was written so that we all very clearly in the Bible are prophets, priests, and kings. We're a royal priesthood. Everybody who comes to Christ, there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free. We have been called together to be a royal priesthood. You know what a priesthood does? It represents God to the world. Remember when Israel was called to Mount Sinai, the Lord wanted to make them a nation of priests. Remember that? And God shows up in a spectacular form. The Lord was speaking to us about this once, and he said, do you know why I made it so spectacular? I wanted them to understand that I'm an awesome God. Okay, so he shows up. I mean, we're talking trumpet blasts and lightning and shaking earth. You know, it's the type of stuff that rattles your eye teeth. And he shows up on the mountain, and he starts talking to all of Israel. There's no mediator. This nation is supposed to be the mediator between God and man. And so he's talking to the whole nation. And the nation, what do? They go to Moses and say, you talk to him. We don't want to hear this. They were terrified. And so God said, okay, what they're asking is good. We'll make a priesthood. Now, did God know that was going to be the way it was? Of course. But that was to prophesy to what was coming. What was coming was a time when we were going to be that royal priesthood, where there were no mediators between God and his people, that we were all the priesthood, which was would be mediating God to the world. That was God's purpose and his plan from the very beginning. He has made some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people to mediate his life to the world. We're all a royal priesthood. What happened? And the reason that the Nicolaitans, I believe, what they were became lost in history is because they won. They won. Because very quickly, the clergy class began mediating God to the people. It's a form of control. The clergy class began mediating God to the people in a way where the people were no longer the royal priesthood. We lost that. The Reformation has been in the process of restoring it, and it is being restored. However, we still have some remnants of that. And one of the ways that we emphasize that role distinction, where there's clergy and laity, instead of recognizing that we're all brothers and sisters before Christ, where we believe there's a modern-day priesthood mediating God to the people, which is untrue. We all have the Holy Spirit indwelling us. The reason that we believe that is because I believe way back in the dark realms of history is the Nicolaitans won, and the reason that they don't know what the Nicolaitans did is because the guys, you know, it was outside of their mindset. This can't be what we're doing. And so Jesus says in Matthew chapter 23, he said, you are not to be called rabbi, for you have only one master and you are all brothers. And do not call anyone on earth father, for you have one father and he is in heaven. Nor are you to be called teacher, for you have one teacher, the Christ. The greatest among you will be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. That's a frightening set of scriptures, honestly, because the Lord of the universe, did I say the Lord of the universe? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords says he's got a problem with titles. You just heard that, right? He's got a problem with titles. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who's ruling all things on our behalf, has a problem with titles. And what's the problem that he has with titles? He says, well don't use this title because you only have one master. Rabbi means my master. And you think, oh my goodness. Jesus came right out and said, don't be called rabbi. And yet we all know Christians who are called rabbi. And you think, don't they know this verse is in the Bible? It's their traditions. Okay, so whatever their traditions are, God's revealing to them according to the life that they have. I'm just simply saying, I'm pointing out in very stark detail how inconsistent our practice is with the Word of God. teaching moment, right? Do not call anyone on earth Father, for you have one Father, and he is in heaven. So Jesus is giving the reasons. And by the way, just before this section, he says that the religious leaders just like the ego trip that this is. That's what the whole first part of this chapter 23 is all about, ego trips. And he says they love to be called rabbi in the marketplace, be called teacher. They love all that stuff. That's an ego trip for them. It shows everyone how esteemed they are. That's not how the kingdom works. The kingdom works by the greatest of you will be the least, will be the one who serves everyone. So this is contrary to the concept of kingdom. This is contrary to the purposes of the heart of God. He says, so don't be called father. And right away we can think, oh my goodness, there's several denominational structures that they call their priests fathers, whether they're married or not. Oh my goodness, this is horrible. Good thing we don't do that. And then Jesus says, no, nor are you to be called teacher, for you have one teacher, the Christ. And you go, ooh, man, good thing no one calls anybody teacher in the church, or the Latin derivative of it, doctor. This old doctor is a teacher. So all we've done in the evangelical church is we're wise enough not to use a title which Jesus uses in Matthew chapter 23. We just change it into a different language and call it doctor. Because there's doctors all over the place who you have to call them doctor in the church. In evangelical circles, it's the way it is. So we can't say, you know, that denomination, or this is endemic to humanity. Now, by the way, you know, you say, did Jesus just have problems with these three titles? Or do you think the real issue was titles at Fed Eagle? Yeah, you know it. He just pulls three titles, and he says, this is why. He could have probably kept going on. Don't do this, don't do this. He just pulled three titles that made a separation between clergy and laity that put the people in their position, and in order to properly honor the man or woman of God, you have to use a title to approach them. Now, make no mistake about it. I'm a man of God, okay? I am a called pastor of this congregation. I've got a prophetic authority, and God has done amazing, spectacular miracles through the work that I do. But that's my role. My name is Randy. You understand? I am privileged to have been equipped by men and women of God to be using my ministry. And a part of my ministry then is to be able to equip you to go out and even do more than I am doing. Because you then become an extension of the grace that God has given me. And we are together an army of God that is stepping out and doing the purposes of God, serving one another as a team and serving God through being that team. We do not need to call each other titles. Some denominations have said, well, we can only call each other brother and sister. But then, you know, it just becomes artificial. We do have first names. Now, young people, young people need to respect adults. We understand those societal norms. And so, of course, when we have our young people under the age of 18, we ask them to call someone Mr. or Miss. Young kids, some of them will say Pastor Randy, but it's okay. In fact, probably more appropriate if you have them say Mr. Randy. It's just the way it is. It's very important for them to understand the adult-child differentiation. But once they grow to adulthood, obviously they lose that eventually when they get over the discomfort of it, calling people, you know, that's just the way it is. Obviously, Jesus doesn't care if you call your medical doctor doctor. It's not a spiritual role, okay? But why do your doctors have you call them doctor? Because they want you to obey them. If you got too familiar with them, you would not obey them. You would think, oh, this is just advice from a friend. I'm going to ignore it. They require you to call them doctor so that you obey them. That's what titles are for. So we don't use titles because we believe it's antithetical to the purposes of the kingdom of God, and because the Lord, sovereign master of the universe, has told us it's a bad idea. In fact, he didn't just say it's a bad idea. He said, don't do it. Okay. Now, you understand why I said that I'm going to reveal to you the light that I have on the topic so that you don't go out, and especially those of you who are watching online or on television, and beat up your denominational structure because of it. But I am telling you a light that God has given to me. And I think you just heard that logically and scripturally, I probably have more on my side than they have on their side in the use of titles. Because the only thing that they have on their side is it's our tradition or it's a way that people need to respect you. Well, I've been around way too many church structures where people call their pastor pastor and they stab him in the back every step of the way. They belittle him. They keep him poor. That's their way of exacting punishment for the respect that they've been required to give, even of people that are unworthy of respect. And a lot of times, people with the title are unworthy of respect. You have to earn, through your connection to Jesus Christ, the grace and authority for leadership so that people willingly grant you respect, not through a title, but through actually deigning to listen to what you have to say. Okay, that's really how the kingdom works. So, was there one more question or another question from the congregation? Okay, then we will call it at the end today. And again, may I emphasize on that last question? I can get pretty caught up in that question because I believe that God is restoring this whole thing to the church. I have talked to pastors and leaders from different denominations about it and, wanting to be able to help share. It's you usually run into a brick wall. They can't respond and say why their position is biblically correct. It's just that it's so hard to fight tradition. However, God will see that through also. And our stream is not the only stream that does this. You're well aware. There are dozens, if not hundreds, of ministry streams throughout the United States that have this revelation. It's just something that needs to spread out even more in the body of Christ so that people are free to step into their callings and purposes. Every gift, every calling, every purpose in the body of Christ is important as every other gift. The main thing is that we have to go out and use our gifts, fanning them into flame, allowing ourselves to be equipped and used in the kingdom of God in the way that he wants us to be equipped and used. So, okay. Well, that, I think then what Dawn just said was that we do not have any rollover questions until next week, and so we'll call the July question or open forum Sundays over for the month of July. Next week, we'll pop back into the book of John, and we'll be able to see what it is that Jesus is doing. He hasn't been taking a break in the book of John. We have. So let's pray. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity today for us to be able to finish up this question and answer series. I ask that your grace would be released upon us in every way needed so that we are able to grow in your kingdom. Let your life shine through us and in us so that we are able to move forward always in your kingdom. Thank you for the grace that you have given us to be members of your team in this world. In your name, Jesus. Amen.